we flew Andrew G exclusively to Ireland to chat to all four members of the band. It wasn't much of a holiday, there was a horror flight, there was jet lag, but in the end, it was all worth it.
It's the 80s. The musical landscape is dotted with synthesizers, electronic drum kits, and robot dancers. Zoom to 1983, and The Cure make their first splash in the Australian charts. Duran Duran continue to push the boundaries of hair and makeup, while Culture Club clock up, or rather frock up, for three consecutive hits. 83 is also a big year for soon-to-be rock gods INXS and for an Irish four-piece called U2, who score their first two Australian successes with New Year's Day and Two Hearts Beat as One. Straight out of Dublin, with a fire in their belly and God on their side, U2 quickly established themselves as rock contenders. Like many of their contemporaries, U2 favour the mullet and the skin-tight trouser. But unlike nearly all of them, the band U2 survives and flourishes for two, going on three decades.
You are the only band of your vintage that is still vibrant and alive and contributing really positively to the charts. How do you maintain that, you know, modern edge after all this time and not trade upon your nostalgia like so many other bands?
I think it's just down to the fact that, you know, we're excited about whatever kind of music is going off at any given time. So we never necessarily kind of sit on our laurels. We're always going, okay, we want to make that kind of a record, we want to do that kind of a thing.
We are deficient in so many areas that making records is never easy for us, and we're never satisfied. We're always unhappy. So there's this constant search to make it better or to get the great song.
Plus, we're a live act, so we're always aware that whatever record we make, we're going to be taking out to tour at some stage. And you kind of know if the songs aren't cutting it, you know very quickly on stage, so it makes you very kind of hard on the material.
I think what I'm saying is right. We're really fans, first and foremost, and that's how we got into music, was being fans who got caught up by the whole post-punk era excitement and the idea that you don't have to be brilliant musicians to make music that could make a difference. Every time we get excited about somebody else's record, it just inspires us to try and write something that's as exciting for us as listening to our favorite albums from all those years ago and favorite albums that we're still getting into now. So I think that's why it always feels in a way current what we're doing, is because it's very much influenced by what's going on. We don't write in a vacuum, we never have.
If inspired songwriting is the number one reason for U2's survival, then surely number two would be Bono's refusal to cross-dress.
Steady on.
It's no secret that the music charts of the early 80s were awash with men dressed like women and women dressed as men. Culture Club's Boy George and the Eurythmics' Annie Lennox are prime examples. Bono, in stark contrast, always dressed as a bloke in the 80s, and 22 years later, we can say without reservation, it's paid off. Another timely tip out of the U2 book, don't bonk your bandmate. Annie Lennox and Dave Stewart had a great thing going with the Eurythmics in the 80s, both professionally and romantically. But when the relationship went bust, it wasn't long before the band went likewise. Same with Culture Club. Boy George's love affair with drummer John Moss formed the core of the band and fueled most of their music. Things went decidedly sour when John dumped Boy. Fortunately, nobody in U2 has fancied anyone else in U2 in their 25-year history, to our knowledge, though sometimes they act like married couples.
Bono does more of the food and beverage side. I'm more housekeeping, you know, towels, purchases of soap and stuff like that.
Sticking together can be hard when one of your band owns the bulk of the marketable talent. Take The Police, who had two massive singles in 1983, just like U2. But where are they now? the Police suffered from what we'll call the Sting factor. That is, being the best-looking, most charismatic member of the band, Sting took off for a successful solo career. George Michael of Wham did much the same. Off he went, and musical partner Andy Ridgeley barely surfaced again. While Bono has spent time apart from the band crusading for various worthy causes, the band has always been a nice place to come home to.
When Bono first started down the road of, you know, going and campaigning, there was definite unease and a little bit of fear because, you know, we've worked as a band, as four individuals, for such a long time. The idea that somebody might not be around when, you know, you're in the studio working or going through things or doing guitar parts or whatever it is. And that was kind of a scary prospect. But, you know, when Bono came back from his trips, he had sheets and sheets and sheets of lyrics. So him being away actually really suited him and us. And also, as Bono has said himself, he's better in small doses, and I would like to second that.
After the break, 50 Minutes continues our U2 case study on how to survive in rock and roll when all your contemporaries are falling by the wayside.
We play our songs to everyone, to be honest with you. If somebody delivers pizza, we will bring them in. I've done them many times, play them our new album.
Pizza deliverers and cleaning ladies of Dublin helping you two make albums. Next on 50 Minutes. With a quarter of a century under their belts and no lineup changes to speak of, Irish superstars U2 have earned their title of rock survivors. While other bands of their era, the Spandau Ballets and Whams of the world, self-combusted years ago, U2's musical innovation and solid band chemistry have kept their dream alive. And yet, however well you get along as blokes, you don't survive long if you choose to live in some stratospheric wanker layer above the common man. J-Lo might say she knows which block she comes from, but U2 actually still base themselves in their hometown of Dublin.
We play our songs to everyone, to be honest with you. If somebody delivers pizza, we will bring them in. I've done them many times, play them our new album. Everyone, from the cleaning ladies here to our kids, to our mates. And because you, when you're listening to your own music with somebody, you sort of hear it through their ears. And we can, and have, and will do again, disappear up our own arse. So it is nice to have somebody occasionally shout up and say, come down. Dublin is it's a fun place. And we've had, you know, all our family are here, all our friends are here. And really, we are sort of part-time rock stars. You know, there is a sense that we go out, be in a band, you know, play being rock stars, and then we kind of come home to Bubble in Dublin, and we just disappear into the shadows and the lanes and the places that you've just been over the last 24 hours. People have a very interesting attitude to rock stars here in the city. Which is verging on the intolerant. And that kind of suits us. If you've got kids, which we have now, I want them to grow up around a healthy disrespect for money and success.
Tell us about this building. What is this place?
Well, you are in Dublin City, down by the end of the canal system, which is a 19th century system that predates like the big roads. And so 100 years ago, in this little canal basin, which is outside the window here, there would have been hundreds of canal barges filled with all kinds of goods heading up to all parts of the country. We've had a kind of long history with this area. And then I guess about, 10 years ago, we discovered this building was for sale, and we bought it, and we put our studio in here, and we've been making records here ever since.
It's nice to know that even the biggest band in the world has a band room that's just secondhand furniture and a bunch of guitars lying around.
Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble, but you two show that it works in your favour long term. Adopt a self-deprecating tone, look after your fans, and offer evidence of your own fallibility for best results, especially if you're guilty of giant lemons.
This pure Spinal Tap, obviously all that stuff. we knew as we were making it that we were staring down the tap. And I think, you know, that the laugh was somewhat on us when one night in Norway it didn't open. Anyone who remembers the Giant Lemon, it was part of the Pop Mart tour. It was this huge Mirabeau lemon that revolved and moved slowly down the ramp. At the end of the ramp, it would open slowly and we would walk out down a set of steps. Well, on this occasion, it stopped opening after about 18 inches. So you could kind of see our feet inside, but that was it. And all the smoke and everything was going off, and it was hilarious. We were actually killing ourselves laughing. We do think genuinely that we have the best job in the world, and I think we all feel in a weird way that with all the support and success that we've been given by our fans, that the deal is, you know, you can have the fancy houses and the fancy cars, just don't make crap music, you know. And so that's another reason for us to really be so careful about what we release. You know, we don't want to let people down.
And we were always the runt of the pack. You know, we start off, we were from Dublin, we were always like, maybe not quite as cool as all those other London bands, and you know, we always sort of struggle with that. So we've always had a sort of a fight in our hand. We're fighting Irish, and you know, we can't let go. So we want to be in the charts. We want to be on Top of the Pops. We want to be on your TV show, and we don't want to go into that other place. And
where you're trading off your past.
The last piece of advice we can offer, based on the U2 case study, is don't knock the faith. However unrock and roll it may be, U2 credit their religious convictions with keeping their careers and themselves safe.
For Michael Hutchins.
The careers of INXS and U2 ran parallel courses, both bands tasting commercial success in the early 80s and conquering the world later that decade. In 1997, the year that U2 released their pop album, INXS frontman Michael Hutchins died in circumstances the coroner determined to be suicide.
Wouldn't dare to try to imagine what was going on in Michael's head on that night, but I'll be really honest with you, I get really black sometimes. I get really, really depressed, and I can go very seriously down. But when I do, I never hit bottom. I really never do. There's something underneath it. You know, whatever it is my faith, my belief, you know, that there's, you know, a reason, you know, there's, I've got, whether it's, you know, Ali, whether it's the kids, whether it's about something. I jump, you know, sometimes, you know, off. But I don't ever hit the ground. I don't ever, and I guess Michael did that night, and it makes me ask a lot of questions about myself, or, you know, that's a place I don't want to be in.
My heart is a blue.
Music for us is some kind of, you know, sacrament in the end. We are very serious about that. And of course that makes, you know, that makes you vulnerable, makes you, you know, wide open for a good slagging off for a start. We deserve it. But it also means that people know that there's no front. Now, you may have front, I might have front, but not in the songs. You're completely raw. You know, if you do God's work, God maybe does yours. But it feels like that, because it shouldn't be this good. And so it is just a strange thing. If you look after other people, your own shit gets looked after. It seems to be the way it's working in this band. And now if the album's really shite, next album's really shite, don't blame God. son.
You're the only... Okay, let me put it this way.
I didn't hear that.
Did you hear the word vintage?
No, I don't hear those kind of things.
Yeah, I did not hear that. We did not hear that.
You're the only man with such a great legacy.
He just said the word legacy. Break his legacy.
You're the only guys who've been doing what you've been doing for so long, yet still contributing new, fresh material to the charts and not trading off nostalgia of the past. How do you keep that?
On the other hand, we like that question. Please answer it.